Welcome back. And now it's time for our press review. We are going to take a look at the main headlines of our Egyptian dailies. And first, allow me to welcome my guest for today, Mr. Mustafa Reda. He's a political and economic analyst. First of all,
good morning, sir.
Let me start by taking a look at Al Ahram newspaper. President Abdel Fattah al-Sisi on Thursday received head of the Libyan Presidential Council, Faiz al-Sarraj. And presidential spokesman Ala Youssef said the president stressed Egypt's firm position that supports the unity and stability of Libya and the respect of the Libyan people's will. Well, we have more details in the following report. President Abdel Fattah al-Sisi met head of Libya's presidential council, Faiz al-Sarraj, on Thursday. During the meeting, President al-Sisi stressed Egypt's stance to support Libya's unity and stability, and above all, respect its people's will. El-Sisi asserted that Egypt is keen to support a reconciliation process and a political solution to support Libya's national institutions. The head of state hailed bilateral ties that bind the two brotherly nations that have extended over tens of years. He said Cairo would exert its utmost efforts to create a good atmosphere for dialogue among Libyan factions to solve core issues and settle the country's crisis. For his part, al-Sarraj expressed his appreciation and gratitude to the Egyptian role and efforts exerted to support the Libyan people and to keep the sovereignty of the Libyan territories in this critical period since the fall of former Libyan leader Muammar Gaddafi. Sarraj tackled with President al-Sisi the latest developments in Libya and stressed the significance of negotiations to reach consensus. He asserted that the final settlement to the Libyan crisis should include all Libyan sides, as being united is the only way to regain the country's safety and security. Welcome back. So, moving on, talking about the importance of the situation in Libya, our cooperation with Libya, how do you read the current situation?
Well, the current situation actually is very turbulent, and especially in Libya, I mean, and especially that we have to take into consideration, and that's a very important point, that Libya is on the borders, on the western borders with the Egyptian, geographical country. So it's very, very much important, you see, that we strengthen and we have stability in the Libyan regime, you see, because as we mentioned before, a lot of terrorists, you see, organizations are located in Libya, and they are various, you see, and a lot of them escape. They find an escape way in order to come into Egypt through Libyan borders, the Egyptian-Libyan borders, which are quite more than 1,000 kilometers. And certainly this is very difficult to control. We have to be fair enough, you see, not blaming the army or the police, you see, because it's quite difficult to control these places. So a cooperation between both countries in order to combat terrorism first and then reach stability in the country there is very, very important. And probably this is the avenue that the president took in order to stabilize it for the national security of Egypt, first of all, you see.
Right. Moving on to Akhbar al-Yom. Foreign Minister Sameh Shoukry held an expanded meeting with his German counterpart, Frank Walter, on ways to strengthen the excellent bilateral relations between both countries. This comes within the framework of this consultations with German officials during his current visit to Berlin. The German minister praised the level of cooperation between the two countries and how it reflects the strategic relationship, and expressed his appreciation for the efforts exerted by the Egyptian side in order to reach an agreement on the work of German institutions in Egypt. Shoukry reviewed the various challenges Egypt went through in recent years and expressed aspiration to Germany's support for Egypt, as the stability of Egypt directly helps maintain stability in the region. Well, of course, talking about Germany, and I believe that our relation now in Germany actually achieved a lot in this respect,
yes.
Right? So, talking about this meeting, and especially that we can see that there were many important issues that were discussed, especially talking about the economic status in Egypt and all the reforms and the procedures taken actually to for economic reforms.
I'd like to add to what you mentioned is very important, and I'd like to add what you mentioned just now, that we have to take into consideration that the German country is a major player in the European Union,
yes,
and is considered one of the driving forces, positive driving forces in the European community, you see. So it's very, very important to strengthen our relations with them. and to learn from them, actually, to learn discipline and to learn quality and to learn how to work properly. You see, because I consider that the German model is a role model, you see, that probably even a lot of European countries are trying to follow and they failed, you see. They are very professional, they're very dedicated to work, they're very meticulous, and they're very straightforward, you know, and they are fair, you see. So that's why we saw a real advancement in the economy, in the German economy. Well, even, you see, you should take into consideration that Germany was split into the World War II. And then, you see, all these factors, but it's the human factor that we're talking about again, you see, which I'm concentrating on. That is very, very important in the advancement of the culture. So let us take this as a role model in order for us to imitate, or not to imitate, because it will...
To follow,
yes, to be precise with you, and to enable us to reach probably the growth rate that the government is thinking of reaching here in Egypt, you see. Very, very important.
Right, moving on to Al-Ahram Online. Egyptian border guard forces prevented more than 12,000 people of various nationalities from illegally entering or leaving the country in 2016. A growing number of migrants have in recent years tried to cross to Italy in pearl sea journeys from the African coasts of Libya and Egypt. Crossings are often organized by migrant traffickers in rickety boats that often capsize repeatedly, leading to many deaths. The army said in a statement listing its achievements last year that 12,192 people of various nationalities have been arrested in a total of 434 cases of illegal migration. The army added security forces have destroyed 67 underground tunnels, presumably in Sinai, where it has launched a campaign to eliminate smuggling tunnels between the peninsula and the Palestinian Gaza Strip. Maybe here we have two parts to talk about, but of course the illegal migration is one of the important issues actually that we have to work on. I think we achieved a lot in this respect.
Right, and it's not all, it's not, you see, it's not only Egypt, you see. Probably you heard that all Mediterranean countries are joining forces in order to prevent the incoming and the outgoing. You see, the outgoing is from our place. You see, a lot of people from Sudan, they find it as an escape tunnel in order to go out of the African continent. On the other side, it's the receiving countries which are facing problems. You see, as you know, Europe now and all the world, the worldwide economy is at a slowdown. You see, so they cannot afford more burdens. You know, again, so again, it's the joint efforts between the receiving and the exporting countries is quite important. And I think we had a lot of conferences and a lot of talks in this respect between the Mediterranean countries during the past period. You know, again. The problem, I think it's not a problem, it's the problem is immigrants is a side problem. The problem is that we have to reach the stability in the Middle East. We have to ask ourselves why these people would like to leave this region and go to another region. It is in Syria, certainly the situation, as you know, is drastic, you know. People are dying every day, so we cannot blame them, you see. You have to be fair again, you see. If you are in that situation, you're finding everyday people be dying and people being killed and all that. So it's the stability of the Middle East is going to solve this problem. This is the core problem. It's not the problem that why we should see why these people would have to leave the country. This is very, very important.
And of course, talking about the tunnels and what was achieved by the army as
yes.
well, because this
Definitely.
Is, yes, of course,
yes.
for the national security. Let me move on to Akhbar Al-Yom to take a look at another headline. The Russian Transport Ministry announced the resumption of inspection visits at the airports of Hurghada and Sharm el-Sheikh with a five-day visit by experts. The last visit by a Russian inspection delegation was in December 2016. The delegation team inspected arrival hall number 2 in Cairo Airport, from where Airflot Russian airline flights land and take off. The team praised the level of procedures and preparations at the building and called for the need to expedite the installation of biometric fingerprint devices. The Egyptian Civil Aviation Ministry announced in a statement on Wednesday that the Russian delegation had arrived to resume inspections in airports. The chairman of the holding company for airports and air navigation, Mohammed Said, said the fingerprint devices will arrive from Germany Thursday, after which the company will start immediately installing them on entry doors to building number 2 at Cairo Airport for workers. Said said biometric fingerprint devices had been installed in Sharm el-Sheikh and Hurghada airports. Official sources with Hurghada International Airport said the Russian team comprised 7 experts in aviation security, noting that airport management has completed the installation of inspection and X-ray devices, increased the storage capacity of surveillance cameras, and installed 14 biometric fingerprint devices for airport workers.
Again, I'd like to comment on this. I'm glad that you put this item in the news, you know. However, it's not only Egypt. You see, we have, again, I'd like to refer back again to the Paris-Cairo crash which occurred. You see, there are leaks in all airports. We should have to be fair, you know. So concentrating on our procedures, it's unfair because we have very strict procedures. It should be worldwide applied, you see, because the terrorists, you see, as you can know, they find escapes, you know, in Cyprus it happened, in France it happened. So it's a matter of
that. On air it happened that people are air, killed.
Yes.
The Russian. Right, so, of course, in Turkey.
Exactly. So it's, again, you see, it's not only our problem. It's the worldwide problem. And again, should the, these devices, you see, improving information, you see, state-of-the-art information devices, like the one you just mentioned now, fingerprints, data about everyone, you see, the new computerized system for the passports, you know, which are electronic, when you scan them like that, you get the information immediately on your computer. And on all, we should really actually have all these devices worldwide, you see. So we have a network, an international network, so that anyone, for example, in any country is going to try and to enter, we could know all the data. It should be a central database in order to give us information about everyone. And it's very simple. By scanning your passport, you see, the electronic passport, the new one, you can get information, and you can also, it's very important, the controls on the ground, you see, before the takeoff, and because there are a lot of ground people, personnel, that could skip some things, items into the plane when they're cleaning the plane, when they're trying to put the catering services, they're trying to supply catering services to the takeoff and landing for airplanes. These people have to be monitored and very carefully chosen, you know, because these people could smuggle or put up anything in the plane. Example, for when you go into the luggage, you know, when they store the luggage in the aircraft before you leave, someone could put something in the hat rack, you know. It's very, very simple, you know. So it's very, very important to choose these people, to monitor them and to check them in and out on a regular basis.
Right, back to Al Ahram newspaper. Egypt's Grand Mufti Shawki Alam held a meeting in Cairo on Thursday with a visiting Dutch parliamentary delegation, in which he said that terrorism and violent extremism constitute a threat to every country in the world. The 12-member Dutch delegation arrived Monday night in Cairo to meet with Egyptian officials and representatives for 2 days before returning to the Netherlands on Thursday. In the meeting with Egypt's Grand Mufti, attended by the Dutch ambassador in Cairo, Alam stressed that terrorism will not be defeated without international solidarity, and that every country in the world must play a role. The religious leader praised the Netherlands' support for the people and the government of Egypt in combating the terrorist threat. And I think this is related to what you were talking about, right?
Yes, it's cooperation again, you see. And this gives us a very good sign, you see, that now delegations from European countries are coming to discuss the issue, because you see, in the past they neglected all that. Now they found out that the problem is going to them, you see, so they are trying to have a worldwide cooperation in this respect.
Right, moving on to Al Waft newspaper. The Egyptian exchange extended gains to the third consecutive day after the main index EGX 30 closed Thursday 1.3% higher to 13.224 points. The small and mid-cap EGX 70 also rose 1.34% to 473 points. The broader index EGX 100 ended up 1.7% to 1,154.4 points. and the equal weighted index EGX 50 increased 1.97%. How do you read this?
Again, you see, this is due to the liberalization of the Egyptian pound. You know, when we had the two rates for the Egyptian pound, you see, you used to find that the stock market used to go up and down. You know, now, if you monitor the performance of the stock market, it has been dramatically going up eventually. You see, since we had the floating of the Egyptian pound, because now people can...
Of course, they gained a lot. I think they are the one of the money. Important yes. sides, like the banks who gained a lot
of a lot of money of yes. this business, yes. However, but this again constitutes a sort of stability, because if you see it, if we talk about the market going up, it means that a lot of people are pouring money into the stock market, not pulling out of it. You see, in the past we had in and outs. Now it's going up, and if you monitor...
But again, this has to do with the foreign...
Exactly.
Investors.
Yes.
Because of course they won't lose a lot if they are going to buy or
no.
be involved. Yes, of course.
Exactly.
But
you're right.
What I can say that it is not a real indicator
for the economy.
Yes.
I agree with you.
Right. Let me move on to or continue with Al Ahram newspaper. In her essay in U.S. Washington Times, Minister of International Cooperation Dr. Sahar Nasr said the government is committed to engage youth as a driving force for change, adding that the youth is the main driver of development in Egypt. She pointed out that Egypt's core asset and main engine of growth is its youth. Its total population of more than 92 million is characterized by a demographic youth bulge, with a young median age of 23 years compared to 37 in the United States and 46 in Germany. The minister said in a speech that attaining high economic growth and creating jobs through efficient utilization of Egypt's young human capital requires the transition from an efficiency-driven economy towards a more innovation one. How to get use of this?
Well, actually...
This is, again, the human resources, actually.
Yes, again, but you see, I have this is a very good comment, you see, but unfortunately, we had a lot of slogans and, you know, a lot of... good items, you see, and good objectives, you see. Unfortunately, we didn't see what is the action plan, how we're going to achieve this, you know. So this is very important to, we've been talking about the youth, and the president made the conference and all that. Again, still we don't have an action plan. How we're going to achieve these objectives, you know. It's very good. The statements are excellent. But how I'm going to reach, how I'm going to encourage the youth to work, how am I, what type of jobs I'm going to, are the jobs adequate to the needs of the market, you see, because unfortunately, the market, market needs are different than the qualifications available in the market, you see. There's a big gap, you see. How are we going to fail all this? I suppose that an action plan has to be set up in order to reach these objectives. This is very, very important.
Right, and finally from Al Wafd newspaper, renowned Egyptian actress Karima Mukhtar dies at 82. Mukhtar starred in dozens of popular films, plays, and TV dramas over the course of more than half a century. She was born in Asyut, Upper Egypt, on the 16th of January 1934. Mukhtar started her career in entertainment in the 1950s, on the popular Egyptian children's radio show, Baba Sharu. Her first role on the big screen came in the film, Taman al-Hurriya, or The Price of Freedom, and that was in 1963. Her convincing role as Zainab, a mother of seven, in the highly successful film, Al-Hafid, and that was actually in 1974, opposite the late Noor al-Sharif and Mirvet Amin, earned her popular acclaim. And of course, our condolences that we lost one of the most prominent, actually, Egyptian actresses. And actually, she will remain forever with all the works that she produced. Well, with this, we come to the end of our press review for today. And we extend special thanks to our guest, Mr. Mustafa Rida, is a political and economic analyst. Thank you very much, sir, for joining us. And still, we have more to bring you. So stay tuned. We'll be back right after the break to resume our breakfast show.
Be the first to know. The news live at the site of the event. information on events as they are happening. If it's breaking news, it's Nile TV.